Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the webinar. I'm Jane Owen Lynch, Professor and Pro Vice Chancellor for Teaching and Learning here at the University of Huddersfield. I'd like to welcome you to this evening's In Conversation webinar, What's the Secret of COVID's Success? Before I introduce the speakers, a little bit about the university. The University of Huddersfield has a growing reputation as an inspiring, innovative provider of higher education. It annually enrolls over 19,000 students to an increasingly multicultural campus that welcomes students from over 120 countries onto a range of undergraduate and postgraduate programmes. The university is recognised as a leader in enterprise and innovation and has been the recipient of many awards, including Times Higher Education Magazine's awards for the University of the Year, Outstanding Leadership and Management, and is also a recipient of a Queen's Award for Enterprise. So tonight's conversation is with Professor Karen Ousey, our Director of the Institute for Skin Integrity and Infection Prevention, and Dr. Sarah Jarvis, MBE. Karen is a visiting professor at Queensland University of Technology in Australia and the Royal College of Surgeons. She's also a fellow of the Royal Society for Biology. Currently, Karen is a member of the National Wound Strategy Group, and her research interests focus on skin integrity, infection prevention, management of surgical site complications, and improving access to education for all healthcare professionals and service users. Sarah is our newly appointed visiting professor of general practice and patron of the Institute for Skin Integrity and Infection Prevention. She's a GP, a trainer of GPs, and a fellow of the Royal College of General Practitioners, GPs. She trained at both Cambridge and Oxford and became a partner in an inner city London general practice in 1990. Sarah has been a GP trainer for over 25 years and is also an active medical broadcaster. She's the doctor on several national television and radio stations, including BBC channels, and is also clinical director of Patient Info, a health information website providing information to over 10 million users a month. Sarah combines her clinical and broadcasting skills to moderate educational events across the world. And Sarah, we are absolutely delighted to welcome you to the University of Huddersfield as a visiting professor. In tonight's webinar, Karen will provide an insight into the School of Human and Health Sciences and the institute that she directs. And then Karen and Sarah will be discussing pandemics, COVID-19, and exploring what the new normal may look like. We will have time towards the end of the webinar for questions, so please pop any questions into the Q&A box. I'd now like to hand over to Karen Ousey, our Professor of Skin Integrity and Director of the Institute of Skin Integrity and Infection, to take this webinar forward. Thank you, Karen.
Thank you very much, Jane. And thank you all for being at this In Conversation with both myself and Sarah Jarvis. So the School of Human and Health Sciences is the largest school within the university, where we teach all healthcare professionals except for medics. The Institute of Skin Integrity Infection Prevention is the skin institute within the university. And we're a collaboration of four schools within the university with an ethos of bench to bed. So what we try and do is ensure that our research is real life, looking at issues that are affecting clinical practitioners and patients and attempting to find solutions to them, as well as having our blue sky research for new innovations that can help again patients, the carers and clinicians in a global way. We're combined of academics, practitioners, international experts and service users, because we're very much aware that everybody has skin, therefore skin is everybody's business. And we want to make sure we can make this difference to our patients. So what do we do within the Skin Institute? Well, we have computing and engineering, health sciences, art design and architecture, and applied sciences amongst some of our key leaders. And what we look at is antimicrobial resistance. which has never been really more important than since the pandemic has emerged. And we know that if we don't take this very seriously, by 2050, there's going to be 10 million excess deaths caused as a result of antimicrobial resistance, which is actually more than cancer. So you can see why this is so important, and so important why we ensure things like antimicrobial stewardship are in place and understood by clinicians, patients and carers. We also do a lot of work into skin tears, which is often an overlooked area of skin integrity, with people just thinking it's just a small cut. But as you can see from the slide in front of you, it's far more than that. We've also investigated during the pandemic the use of PPE and the effect it's had on skin damage for practitioners as well as patients. And you've all seen the pictures of the nurses that had the masks on all day long, then they had really bad skin afterwards. The other area we very much look at is identification, management and treatment of wound infection. And we work very closely with the International Wound Infection Institute. And all this is just a taste of what we do, but it's there to improve outcomes, as I say, for patients, carers and clinicians. So tonight I'm going to be in conversation with Sarah. Sarah and I actually had a conversation roughly 12 months ago, looking at COVID, obviously right at the beginning of the pandemic. So it's going to be interesting to see what's changed. But as Jane kindly said earlier, Sarah trained at Cambridge and Oxford before becoming a GP and being awarded an MBE in 2018 for her services to general practice and public understanding of health. But you'll all know from the television and the radio, because she's been providing a reassuring voice and reliable, sensible medical advice for the nation and beyond. And I'm absolutely delighted that she's patron for the Institute for Skin Integrity and Infection Prevention and is our newest visiting professor here at the university. And in line with that, I am probably even more excited to be able to announce a new PhD opportunity, which is the Sarah Jarvis PhD. And this is in recognition of Sarah and all her great work she's done and working with us at the university and within the Institute. So I'm going to announce this evening a fee waived PhD that people may apply to on a focus on the broad topic of how do we anticipate and manage the risks of the next pandemic, because sadly, this isn't going to be the last one. We want your ideas, and the deadline for applications is on the 25th of October this year to commence in January 2022. If you are interested, if you go to our website, all the details for applying are on there and a brief overview of what we'd like you to look at. But without further ado, I would like to stop sharing this now and go into conversation with Sarah. So Sarah, once again, 12 months ago, since we first spoke about this, and not actually thinking that we'd be here 12 months later, still chatting to each other about it.
Well, I have to say, I did think we probably would be. I certainly hoped we would not be. And I certainly hoped that I wouldn't be as busy as I was right at the outset of the pandemic. But sadly, things have gone up and down at the rate of knots. And of course, the problem is, I think what's really upset me is the amount of misinformation that there is now, which was probably summed up by, of course, I'm sure people saw, and I hope were as horrified as all of us were, by the anti-lockdown protest in Trafalgar Square at the end of last week, when Kate Shemanani, who has been struck off by the nursing register, an ex-nurse, stood on the gates or stood and addressed the crowd and suggested effectively that they should be at the Nuremberg trials. She said the doctors and nurses stood trial and they hung. If you are a doctor or nurse, now is the time to get off that bus. And I have to say, even a year ago, I never for a moment, sadly, imagined we would live in a world like that.
No, it's really, it's brought out the worst in people, but it's also brought out the best in people, especially when we saw the Thursday night clap and all the great work that people have done as well to support clinicians and patients as well. We've got to remember about people that are living with long COVID and their families. But one of the things I really want to ask you about, and this may be my ignorance a little bit.
Impossible.
But, of course. But why do pandemics occur? Sarah?
It's a really great question. And the answer is they have occurred throughout history. They occur when we get, rather than drift, we get shift in the genome of a virus. So effectively, pandemics occur because every year, as we know, we have a flu, we have flu cases. And as time goes on, what happens is that every so often you get a significant change in the genomic. So basically, it is an outbreak of global proportions. It happens when there are enough people who are susceptible to it that it can spread widely or rapidly. And what we see, for instance, in the, say, the flu pandemic of the big one that we all think about, perhaps, is the flu pandemic of 1918, 1919, which killed far, far more people than the First World War, and which was ably abetted, unfortunately, by the way in which they dealt with it. Because, of course, what they would do is somebody would get flu, go down with flu. They would put them on a crowded troop ship or a troop train and send them off to an even more crowded troop hospital in order to infect more people. Now, we think we know a great deal more about it now, but unfortunately, of course, sadly, we probably don't. Now, there had been research going on actually some years before the pandemic looking at how these viruses emerge and what sort of vectors they have. We think it's quite likely that many of the previous vectors arose in bats, but there has to be a vector which can then get them into animals. And for instance, in the case of the MERS virus, the Middle Eastern respiratory virus, that vector was a camel. Now, what we then see is that in order to be really successful, the virus has to keep people alive long enough for them to spread it. But actually, after that, it doesn't matter what happens to those people. It also has to be able to evade their immune systems. So what we, for instance, saw in the 1918-19 pandemic is we got a disproportionate number of young, relatively healthy people. And we were very, very worried at the outset of this pandemic about something called the cytokine storm, whereby the body's immune system rushed to prevent the infection. If you had a very strong immune system, then actually it caused far, far more damage than the original condition itself did. And of course, you see that very similarly with sepsis, for instance. So, you know, you get septicemia where you get blood poisoning or the blood blood circulates throughout the body, so-called bacteremia in the bloodstream. But then the actual sepsis is the body's overwhelming reaction to it. What we've interestingly seen on this occasion is that, of course, we have not had that overwhelming death rate among young, previously healthy people. And it seems that their immune systems did not overreact. But what we've got is a perfect storm. We've got a place where, for instance, in China, there are many, many situations in which all these viruses can circulate in their vectors. They can then spread to humans. And it was frankly only a matter of time before we got one which was different enough that we didn't recognize that our body's immune system didn't recognize it and we couldn't fight it off. And that basically means pretty much everybody is susceptible to it.
So it sounds we've seen these other pandemics, as you've said, we've seen MERS and SARS and Ebola. But why haven't we learned from it, do you think, Sarah? Because it's not new, like you say.
It's absolutely categorically not new. And of course, we need to learn globally. We need to learn to treat our planet better and we need to think more seriously about our planet. Now, interestingly, with MERS and SARS and Ebola, with Ebola, they got in fairly quickly. It kills people extremely rapidly. The secret possibly of COVID's success is that people firstly are infectious for 2 or 3 days before they get symptoms, and they can be wandering around spreading it beautifully before they get symptoms. The second is that it spreads by aerosol spread, or largely spreads by aerosol spread. And this is where all the discussion about face coverings have come out. At the outset of the pandemic, we thought, because pretty much every virus had been like this before, that what we were actually looking at was a flu type virus where the vast majority of spread was going to be from droplets. In other words, you coughed or you sneezed them out and either somebody else breathed them in. But actually those droplets, because they're held in droplets, they're quite heavy. They drop fairly quickly, or they landed on something and you had so-called fomites where you picked up a virus from a contaminated surface. In fact, perhaps the secret of COVID's success is that you breathe out this cloud of aerosol and you end up with a sort of donut around you of the virus, of aerosol infected virus. And the longer you sit in one place, the denser that cloud becomes. When somebody breathes it in, they get a greater viral load, and therefore they may end up with more severe illness. And that's why, of course, we've now added fresh air. And fresh air actually probably ought to be right up at the top of the hands, face, space, fresh air message.
Now that's interesting, because one of the questions that's just popped up in the box, Sarah, is should we all stop wearing our masks? Now we have no legal restrictions in the UK to do so.
Well, we do have restrictions outside England, actually. England is only one of the devolved nations which has said no. And I think anybody listening here from Scotland or Northern Ireland or certainly Wales would be very, very upset because actually there was the Welsh government, I think, put out a tweet saying no mask, no Wales. And personally, I think they are extremely sensible. So I was approached about 2 weeks ago by a confederation led by the NHS Confederation, the British Medical Association, the Academy of Medical Royal Colleges, the Richmond Group of Charities and several cancer charities. And I was asked to give my support and be the face of a campaign called #NotTooMuchToMask. And I think I'm probably the perfect person to do it, because at the outset of the pandemic, on the basis of the evidence, I was really concerned that we could do more harm than good by wearing face coverings. Now, if you do something and it doesn't do any harm, you might say, well, why not? But at the outset of the pandemic, the European Centre for Disease Control was saying, well, cloth face coverings, actually, you get virtually no protection for yourself. You don't stop yourself passing on droplets effectively, and people should be self-isolating if they're infected and they're spewing out droplets anyway. And you can increase the risk of contamination by touching your eyes, your nose, and your mouth if you're wearing them. So at the outset of the pandemic, I went with the recommendation of the European Centre for Disease Control and the evidence they had on the basis of previous viruses and the World Health Organization, neither of whom were recommending face coverings. But, and here's the big but, over the course of 2 or 3 months, it became increasingly clear that aerosol spread was a concern. So by the second half of last year, I was very much convinced that the evidence has changed. And as a very famous economist, Maynard Keynes, always said, when the evidence changes, I change my opinion. What do you do, sir? So I have very much changed my opinion. My feeling is that we have had this apparent drop in cases for 6 days running. I have to say, I wish it were likely. I hope it does turn out to be real. My fear is that it's for a combination of factors, including people meeting more outdoors because the weather was hot, people deleting the app, people not getting themselves tested, people not being prepared to give up their contacts because they're worried about them having to self-isolate, and children not being at school and therefore not testing so much with lateral flow tests and therefore not ending up being tested formally for COVID. So I think all of those things may well mean that actually this is not a real reduction, because what we've seen from the latest Office of the National Statistics figures, which took us as far as the 21st of July, is that the cases were going still inexorably up. But the point is that as a result, everyone's gone, oh, well, we've all opened up and cases are going down, so we can stop. Actually, firstly, the increase in cases we're likely to see from opening up hasn't kicked in. Secondly, 16 to 24 year olds, who are the ones who are going out to the nightclubs, have an infection rate which is 6 times higher than people in their 50s and 60s. And thirdly, masks don't protect you. Cloth face coverings don't protect you. They are there to protect the person opposite you. And you don't know whether that person is vulnerable, even if they have been vaccinated. The likelihood of developing coronavirus or dying from coronavirus about doubles with every 7 years of age. So somebody who is 15 is half as likely to die as someone of 22, 4 times less likely to die than somebody of 29. They are 8 times less likely to die than somebody of 36. By the time you've got somebody who is 35 years older, somebody say in their 70s, they can be, you know, 180 times more likely to die than somebody in their 20s. So even though the vaccines have been spectacularly effective and reduce your chance of hospitalization by up to 90%, what that means is they're cutting your risk by 20-fold. Well, if you started off 160 times more likely to die from COVID, then even with vaccination, you are still 8 times more likely to die from COVID than someone in their 20s who hasn't been vaccinated.
Yeah, and that's really interesting, because we've hailed the vaccine as a great success, and some people think being vaccinated so I can just carry on with my life as normal, why should I worry? But then there's these other people that say, I don't want a vaccine because it's not been tested and they're going to put a chip in my arm, that sort of thing. Why do you think this is happening?
Well, let's start with let's discount the microchips in the arms, because yes, that's just, you know, complete and utter nonsense. And we've had people, for instance, who, you know, ended up saying, oh, I got injected with the virus and it contains metal and there's a microchip in it, so now magnets stick to my arm. Well, that's just, you know, I'm completely laughable. If you think about it, you know, sodium is a metal. So, you know, every time you eat a teaspoon of salt, is a magnet going to stick to you? It really, really is laughable. But if we think about where vaccines came from, now vaccines have had a checkered history, and they had a checkered history in some respects for good reason, because there has been a very unedifying and shameful history of people from ethnic minorities, people from deprived populations, who have been very badly served by health authorities many decades, perhaps centuries ago. But certainly in the 19th century, for instance, English government, you tried to make smallpox vaccinations compulsory, and there were protests. Now, vaccines had pretty shoddy safety records because, of course, they didn't go through anything like the same testing that they have now, and we didn't know as much about them. But the point was that vaccines were also closely linked to the poor law legislation, and that forced workers and families into the workhouse. So people associated forcing you to get vaccinated with being forced into the workhouse. Now, people are going, oh, it's against my civil liberties, to which my response, I'm afraid, is, well, actually, it's, you know, if you have the vaccine, you have possibly a 1 in a million chance of dying as a result of having that vaccine. That is magnitudes, orders of magnitude higher than anybody's chance of dying if you get the virus. And let's just put that into perspective. It is orders of magnitude lower than the chance of you dying if you drove without insurance, without having learned to drive, on a motorway. Do we say that it's infringing people's civil liberties, that they are not allowed to drive without a driving license on a motorway at 130 miles an hour? You tell me.
It's all about perspective, and it really has brought some strange ideas out. Yeah. But now we talk about vaccines as well. There's two things I want to ask you about. The first one is, and a question has come through asking the same thing, it's what about a booster?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So I am actually going to be spending tomorrow taking a day off from the practice. I'm spending tomorrow working for Public Health England to raise awareness of the need for young people to get their boosters, because we're in a really quite worrying situation with respect to young people. Over 95% of over 80s have had double vaccination, but they've had at least, and over 95% have had at least one vaccination, virtually all of them two vaccinations. But actually among young people, among 18 to 30 year olds, about a third haven't had any vaccination at all. Now, you need to get two vaccines in order to get full protection from the Delta variant. With the previous one, we got good protection. With a single vaccine now, you need two vaccines to give you really good protection. They need to be at least 8 weeks apart. We made the decision in the UK to go with 12 weeks initially in December. And at the time, it was on the basis that way we could provide partial protection to twice as many people. But interestingly, it was done on the basis of good scientific evidence that has since been proved absolutely right. And what that scientific evidence was, that if you delay the second vaccine, you get a better, a more profound immune response. And particularly, you get a better T cell response. There are two different types of immunity. One of them is B cells, and B cells are the ones that make antibodies. The other are T cells. And T cells help. They help your immune system to rush to the spot and fight it off. They also include memory cells, and they're the ones that actually remember that you've been exposed to it before and allow you to mount an immune response. So if we got a third of the population, third of the about 3 million people, third of 18 to 30 year olds, who, even if they all went out and tried to get their vaccine tomorrow, by the time they get their booster, which will need to be at least 8 weeks later, we will be getting into mid-September. And in mid-September, the plan is to roll out a booster. The reason that we want to roll out a booster is because we know that antibodies to the vaccine do wane over the course of months. What we do not know is how much that translates into more susceptibility, but we suspect that there may be some more susceptibility to the virus as the antibodies wane. Again, your immunity depends partly on your antibodies and partly on your T-cell immunity, and we can't measure how susceptible people are to infection as a result of T-cell immunity, but we can measure antibodies waning. So the idea is that they're going to vaccinate in two phases. The first phase is going to be anybody over 70, all frontline health and social care workers, anyone who lives in an older person's residential home, anyone who is immunosuppressed, because the evidence is that they don't mount quite the same level of immune response. And I think I may have missed one. Oh, clinically extremely vulnerable people. In other words, people who were told that they needed to shield in the first wave of the pandemic. After that, they are then going to expand it from those over 70s and other groups. And in wave two, they will be vaccinating anybody over the age of 50 who hasn't yet been vaccinated, and anybody aged 16 to 49 who is in a clinically vulnerable group, along with anyone who lives with someone who is immunosuppressed. Now, it makes perfect sense to do it in that order. The immunity for immunosuppressed people does appear to wane more quickly. The antibodies wane more quickly. So we want to top them up as quickly as we possibly can. But we also, of course, will then be boosting the people who were immunized first. So they are longest away from their original vaccines.
Do you think you'll see that every year then, Sarah, like we'll go and get, well, some of us may go and get the flu jab once a year. We'll go and get the COVID jab once a year as well.
I think we may well do. I suspect that in time, what tends to happen in time with these viruses is that they become less deadly. Now, people talk all the time about, oh, this virus is less deadly. And I have gone head to head many times with a notorious anti-everythinger called Beverly Turner, who pretends she knows the science. And then actually, of course, you can undermine it fairly quickly, because one of her arguments was, oh, well, all viruses become less virulent with time. No, they really, really don't. And in fact, we've seen that in this pandemic. So for instance, the Alpha variant, which first arose in Kent, is A, much more transmissible, and B, about 30% more likely to end you up in hospital. The Delta variant is about twice as likely to end you up in hospital, as well as being about 60% more transmissible. So what that now means is that we have 10 people with the original version of the virus who would on average spread that virus to 25 other people. Now with the Delta variant, 10 people would spread that virus to 60 to 70 other people. As time goes on, more people will have some protection because they previously had antibodies or because they've been vaccinated, and the virus may or may not become less virulent over time. That is not guaranteed, and we have seen the opposite so far in the pandemic. However, what we will almost certainly end up with is having to produce new vaccines, just as we do for flu, so that the most common variants of coronavirus are the ones against which we offer protection every year.
So we've seen Alpha, Beta, Delta, and I'm running gamma. Out of gamma. Yes, I'm not very good at this alphabet, as you can tell. But the signs and symptoms have changed as well, Sarah. So at the beginning, it was quite easy in a way, because you lost your sense of smell. You thought, right, I've got COVID. But now coronavirus itself is, like you say, is mutating, becoming quite clever. So what are the sorts of signs and symptoms we should be looking for now?
Well, those same signs and symptoms of fever and cough are important. Very few people with the Delta variant lose the sense of taste and smell, which is good, because actually not all of those people got it back again. Quite a lot of people would lose it for several months afterwards. But what we are tending to see with the Delta variant, and this is from the Zoe COVID app, where millions of people have reported their symptoms, the most common symptoms appear to be sore throat, runny nose, and runny nose, sore throat, and headache. So those are very much more like the common cold. So, and this may account for some people, of course, mistaking it and therefore going out and spreading it. And my personal feeling is that what we should have said is that we should have added sore throat and runny nose and got those people to get themselves tested as well. We haven't I don't make the policy. But yes, sore throat, runny nose and headache. If you get any combination of that, then it is definitely worth self-isolating, getting yourself tested.
Now, sadly, Sarah, you've just opened the door up for me to ask you a question about what's the government done well? Then I'll ask you what they haven't done so well. So we'll do the quick answer first.
Okay, we'll do the quick answer first. They've done two things really, really well. The first is vaccinations. They have done an amazing job with vaccines. We have rolled out very, very quickly. We're the first country in the world to get the vaccine program up and running. Of course, that wasn't courtesy of the government. That was courtesy of a combination of the MHRA, who have done an absolutely amazing job, and the JCVI. But to give them their credit, Kate Bingham, who headed up the vaccine task force, has been really, really good. And basically, she went out there to say, right, I'm going to get vaccines. I'm not going to make the same mistakes, which we'll come to in a minute, as we did at the start of the pandemic. The second thing that we've done really, really well is genomic testing. And again, that's not the government, that's the scientists, but we have done extraordinary things. One of the reasons that we've picked up so many of these new variants is because we are testing more than virtually any other country in the world. And we have the capacity, which the government has invested in, has scaled up, which has allowed us to test more quickly, as well as more effectively and higher numbers than anyone else. And that allows you to detect new variants very quickly. Of course, the other thing they've done, and again, this again isn't really the government, it's what we've done really well in the UK, is development of vaccines. And the University of Oxford, the University of Cambridge, they've actually between them done unbelievable work. It happens, we all know about the University of Oxford vaccine, the University of Oxford / AstraZeneca vaccine, because they were the ones who got there first. But let's make no mistake, absolutely no corners have been cut in the development of this vaccine. And one of the reasons I think people are so wary and go, oh, what about long-term side effects, is that they fundamentally misunderstand why it takes so long to get a drug vaccine to market. It is not because they are waiting for long-term side effects, because long-term side effects on the whole are vanishingly rare. What does happen are rare side effects. And actually, it's only when you've rolled out a vaccine, usually for many years, that you get those rare side effects, because it's only until then that you get enough people vaccinated. But if we think of the processes that have to go on in order to produce a vaccine, the first thing is that you have to have the science behind it. Well, we have got a decade, 15 years worth of developing vaccines, looking into vaccines for Ebola, looking into vaccines for SARS, for MERS, for malaria, etc. And they were able to build on all of that. The second is that there needed to be funding. And of course, governments were falling over themselves to provide funding for this. So that wasn't an issue. Suddenly, you didn't need to wait for 6, 9, 12 months in order to get the funding. Then we had the ethical approvals, and the governments looked at that they were all sitting waiting and basically dropped everything else in order to do the ethical approvals. Then phase 2 and 3 trials are fundamentally the same thing. Phase 1 trials are the safety trials, the very small doses. Obviously they did those first, but phase 2 and 3 trials were done in tandem during this. And what that did, the reason, it's really a financial reason they do the phase 2 trials work first, because so many drugs fail at the phase 2 trials because they're not effective, that they don't want to invest in doing the enormous trials until they've got the result of the phase 2s. So they were able to carry those out in tandem. Then we have the fact that normally you have to wait a long time to sign people up for vaccine trials. Well, there were 230,000 people in the UK alone, me and my husband included, who signed up for vaccine trials. And across the world, there were so many people signed up for vaccine trials, it took no time whatsoever to get people signed up. Then, once they've had the vaccine, you have to wait usually for long enough for enough people to have caught the infection to see whether there's a difference between the active arm and the placebo arm. And in fact, in our case, in the case of me and my husband, it turned out, when I became eligible for the vaccine, I had myself unblinded, that I got the placebo and he got the real thing. Bitter am I? Heaven forbid that I should be. I got them coverage on The One Show, Channel 5. I did an interview from the waiting room. They watched, they filmed me having my injection. Am I bitter they gave me the placebo? Not a bit of it, Chelsea and Westminster. So no, in all seriousness, they then Because people, so many people were getting the infection, the results of the trials came out really, really quickly. So exactly the same number of people on the trials. They then went through the process for the MHRA. But again, the MHRA basically dropped everything. And during the course of the trials, as each bit of data, they didn't wait for the end of the trial to examine all of the data. They examined each tranche of data as it came in. So they were able to give approval much more quickly. So basically, they just went through all the same approval processes. They just concertinaed them.
And I think that's been really clear. So I think that'll help lots of people understand how it's happened so quickly, really. But we've talked about the good things. Are there, and I know it's unusual to ask this, any mistakes the government may have made, including whether or not restrictions should have been lifted on the 19th of July?
The government has made a very large number of mistakes, in my opinion, during the course of this pandemic. The first was before the pandemic even began. In 2016, there was a pandemic preparedness plan, which the government basically ignored. So what that effectively meant was that we had no facilities. We had no preparation. Then in January, the government was still sending PPE to China. Politically, perhaps not clinically, but politically, this fast track where you could get your mates in, and all the headlines that were in the papers, I think was an absolute disgrace. But clinically, I think that also resulted in problems, because, of course, we ended up having large amounts of substandard equipment which was provided. I think they shut down too late first time around, but more importantly, and I think this is really importantly, they failed to learn the lesson of the first wave. So at the beginning of the second wave in September, what we saw was rapidly rising cases. By this stage, we finally had testing. And of course, we had no testing. And that was absolutely disgraceful. And probably the biggest scandal of all was the discharge of tens of thousands of people into care homes without testing them before they were discharged to make sure that they weren't infected. But we also had no PPE in general practice. We were ordered. We had a new standard operating procedure which ordered us not to see people without assessing them first. Why? Because the government had given us no PPE. They had this theory that they were going to be hot. There were going to be hot hubs where the GPs and so on were going to work, and we were going to send out community teams, but they didn't give us any equipment for that either. So we couldn't do that. We had no PPE. We had no testing, and test and trace and PPEs, the amount of money spent on test and trace for no discernible benefit, because it was centralized rather than being handed to local healthcare, public health teams who knew the community, who were respected by the community, and who could reach people in the community. That, again, was something else they did disastrously wrong. But I think the biggest mistake is not learning from the previous mistakes. By nature, I suppose, Boris Johnson is a libertarian. He doesn't like telling people what to do. And I fear, sadly, therefore, that his theory is, well, we're going to depend on people's natural responsibility. And then when it all goes horribly wrong, we can blame them, because we can say, but we you had the choice. You were the ones who made the wrong choices. And I fear very much that we may well end up in a third lockdown, because, of course, having had Matt Hancock resign, I never thought I'd say it, but bring back Matt Hancock, because he was replaced by a man who tells us that we should not cower from COVID. Well, try telling that to the families of the 140,000 people who died and the 2 million plus people who have ended up with long COVID. So, yeah, I mean, I think perhaps the biggest mistake they've made is not to learn the lessons of the previous pandemics. And the second biggest mistake is to learn not to shut their mouth, not to engage their brains before opening their mouths.
So moving on, I will ask you, somebody sent a question saying it's about travelling overseas or travelling abroad. And should the government give clear advice on travelling abroad? And should we be travelling abroad, Sarah?
Yeah, so it's a really good question. And I have to say, actually, last year, I think the advice was pretty good, even though people hated it. The rationale was, and at the time I was having weekly at the beginning of the outset of the pandemic, actually twice weekly, but throughout the pandemic, I've been having weekly calls with the Deputy Chief Medical Officer and various chief scientific advisors and so on. And we had very, very clear information. For instance, when the guidance was brought in to close down, to make people isolate when they came back from France and Spain, because there was this sudden increase in cases at a time when our case rates were extremely low. There was a dramatic increase in case rates, and it was very, very clear that we should have taken definitive action. In fact, what we did was to give people a deadline of, you know, 2 or 3 days away, which made it basically a game so that as many people as possible could come back into England. Talking of not learning the lessons of the pandemic, we then ended up, for instance, in April, on April the 1st, the predecessor to the Delta variant, which was also first identified in India, was identified as a variant of interest rather than the variant of concern. We did not put India on the red list until the 23rd of April and then gave people 7 days to come in, despite the fact that at the time there were 50 times more people percentage-wise testing positive for COVID among people coming in from India than there were people in the UK at the time. So another example of huge delays. Should we be travelling? Well, I think the answer, given what we've seen about vaccination, the real concern is about vaccine escape variants. And in other words, variants of the virus that the vaccines offer no protection against. That does not so far appear to have emerged in the same way, although the virus, the variant in South Africa, to me, is probably actually more worrying than the Delta variant, because that seems to be the one against which there is significantly less protection from the vaccine. But in order for a variant to be successful, it needs to do two things. Well, the first thing it needs to do is be more infectious, and the Delta variant is much more infectious. To be more disastrous, it needs to do two other things. The first is to make people sicker, and the second is to be resistant to the vaccine, so people don't get the same protection against the vaccine. However, if we look at where we were, if we had looked at where we were, say 3 months ago in terms of cases, I would have been saying, should people go abroad? Well, I would be concerned about that, because many countries had much higher cases and many countries had far, far lower levels of vaccination than we do. We are now in the position where we have very high levels of vaccination among some groups, but we also have a horrendously high level of infection. So my personal feeling is that if I was another country, I wouldn't want us, even if I had been vaccinated. In terms of whether we should expect the vaccinations to change, the criteria to change, the amber watch list and so on. Yes, I think we should, because I think, unfortunately, as a globe, we are putting ourselves, certainly in the UK, we've done a great job of it. We're putting ourselves in the position where we are a petri dish for vaccine resistant variants. We've got large swathes of the population, 40% of 18 to 30 year olds unvaccinated, who are going out and mingling in a big way with a large swathes of the population who are older and not mingling, who aren't vaccinated. And that is a recipe for vaccine escape variants.
And they're the ones that tend to like to go on holiday as well and do a lot of partying.
Yep.
But of course I do as well, Sarah, just have to be in bed for about 8 o'clock in the evening. I think as well, the government of Boris et al. Are looking at herd immunity at the moment now with go out and mix. But I think we're a long way off it, Sarah. And
well, I'm not just it. What really worries me is the idea of herd immunity via natural infection. It's one thing to get herd immunity via immunisation. You probably need, with the Delta variant, at least 85% of the population to have antibodies. Now, probably about 80-90% of the population, adult population, have got antibodies now, largely courtesy of vaccination. Hurrah! But of course, that does not include the child population. Now, in terms of getting immunity via natural infection, yes, all right, what we're talking about mostly now is younger people getting infected. But to me, I think we are all forgetting one thing, and that one thing is long COVID. And long COVID, actually, we're forgetting several things. There's always another thing with me, isn't there? So the most important, though, I think, for young people is long COVID. Young people are by no means immune from long COVID. And for instance, we've heard this concern about young people getting vaccinated, or what about myocarditis? That's the latest health concern with the COVID vaccination. Now, that does appear to be a risk of up to 1 in 25,000 men and one in 250,000 women, mostly aged between 12 and 29. In other countries, of course, they vaccinate from the age of 12. But in most of those cases, they are minor. They're not serious. Put that into perspective, they did follow-up cases on a group of college athletes who had had COVID, not severely, weren't all in hospital with it, all very fit people. And they found an instance of myocarditis among them of one in 40. Not one in 25,000, not one in 250,000, but from natural infection, one in 40 of them had evidence of myocarditis. So I think that long COVID is, for me, the big concern. I think we have an absolute epidemic down the path of long COVID. If you look at, again, at the Zoe app, it depends on which figures you use, but according to the Zoe app, we're probably looking at least 2 million people who have evidence of long COVID. The evidence is that among 12 to 17-year-olds, about 15% of them, 13% of them, and 15% of older people are going to develop symptoms of long COVID. And I think that is, you know, therefore, going down a path of herd immunity is extremely dangerous.
It is worrying. And I think, like you said, we've opened up 19th of July, Freedom Day, because COVID's gone away, but quite clearly it hasn't. And from a personal view, I think, like you, we're going to see a huge rise. But do you think we're going to end up, you said about lockdowns, I can't see us getting lockdowns like we've had before, but maybe making people wear the masks again, social distancing, and having to reopen the nightingales?
Well, I certainly think that everybody should be wearing face coverings, you know, hashtag not too much to mask. Please remember it and share it on Twitter and with any of your friends, because I think it's really, really important you are protecting other people. Because the point about wearing face coverings is they do not infringe your civil liberty. They do not affect the productivity of this country. Yes, there is a tiny minority of people who have severe autism, a tiny minority of people who lip read. And for them, of course, it's appropriate for them to say, please remove your face covering while I'm talking to you because I can't lip read. It's difficult for me. But for the rest of us, it doesn't, you know, it's not affecting the productivity of this country. It's not leading to deprivation, which of course kills just as effectively as COVID kills. So we do need to weigh up the risks and balances of leading this country into too severe an economic depression, which could result in more deprivation. And we know, for instance, if you look at the average life expectancy, there have been so many excess deaths since the pandemic that the average life expectancy in this country has gone down by 0.9 years for women and 1.2 years for men. If you go up to Manchester, the most deprived areas of Manchester, that's 1.6 years. So this is, make no mistake, COVID is a disease that discriminates against poverty. It discriminates against deprivation. So if we can do things that don't have an impact on the economy, whether it's face covering, whether it's working from home, where you can, you know, the Prime Minister seems determined to support the coffee shops that don't pay any rent. All right, there are some which do. But, you know, it strikes me that if we can get people working from home, more hybrid working in the longer term, it'd be better for the environment. In the longer term, it'd be better for the young people who can't afford homes, because believe me, affording a home in the south of England, or pretty much anywhere actually apart from small pockets near Durham apparently, which is one of the cheapest parts of the country, is you know, completely unattainable for the majority of people. So it would make that much more realistic. But it would also protect not just the people who work from home, it would protect the people who can't work from home, those key workers who do have to go into work and who otherwise are traveling on a much more packed truck public transport. So why can't we be thinking about doing things like that and social distancing wherever we can?
Sarah, thank you. I'm just noticing the time, and I know that Jane's had quite a few questions come through as well. As usual, we could chat for hours, days and weeks, but I will hand you back to Jane now for her to ask the questions, and I'm sure we can just chat later about things. Thank you, Sarah. Jane, over to you.
Okay, thank you very much for that discussion. Frank and open, I think I would describe it as. So that's great.
I don't think I'm going to be getting another medal, and they may take my MBE away from me, but you know what? I don't care.
I think you should keep it, Sarah. Thank you. So a couple of questions, I think, actually just that came through before we started. There's one here that says, my husband and I are considering starting a family. What's the latest research on whether COVID itself or the vaccine has an impact on conception and pregnancy outcomes?
I'm really glad this question came up because this is one of the questions that I'm asked most commonly, and I was asked by a patient actually this morning. So this has arisen partly, this issue over pregnancy has arisen partly because naturally, women are naturally very protective when they're pregnant. Secondly, because the original trials on the vaccine, in order to get things out really quickly, in order to get the vaccine approved really quickly, the original trials weren't done on pregnant women. And as a result of that, we initially said, think about your risks and benefits. If you are low risk, then you may not want to get the vaccine during pregnancy, which was translated in, you mustn't get the vaccine during pregnancy because it's not safe. And then we got the anti-vax pseudo scientists. And of course, we all know that the best way to really terrify people is to throw some science at them and make it sound really, really scientific, because it makes it sound more as if you know what you're talking about. I spend my entire life trying to do the opposite. But I'm going to have to use this example they gave here. And they used an example of a protein called syncytin-1. And syncytin-1 is found on the placenta. And the rationale was that the spike protein of the coronavirus is similar to syncytin-1, and therefore it would make antibodies against your placenta. And therefore, women would be infertile and women would lose their babies and their babies would be horribly deformed. Well, actually, the spike protein bears about as much similarity to the syncytin-1 protein as a human being does to a banana. They are really not similar at all. So this was just somebody using pseudoscience. During the course of the trials, women were told not to get pregnant. Now, if the vaccine stops you getting pregnant, you'd have thought they wouldn't be able to get pregnant anyway, or they found it harder. Interestingly, some people during clinical trials do get pregnant, especially when you have really big clinical trials with lots of people, as we did with COVID. And exactly the same number of women got pregnant in the placebo arm as got pregnant in the active treatment arm in the vaccine trials. And then when we finally did, they decided in the US long before they did, when we finally got to the stage where over 100,000 women had been vaccinated against COVID in the US, we weighed that up about against what we knew about COVID infection during pregnancy and said, actually, women should get vaccinated when they're pregnant. And part of the reason for that is, firstly, there were no safety signals, anything different than had been found with the original vaccine for anyone else, no increased risk of getting the vaccine in pregnancy. Secondly, there's no reason to believe there would be, because this is not an active, alive virus. So it's exactly the same as the flu vaccine and the whooping cough vaccine, which we actively encourage women to get. And thirdly, particularly in the third trimester, the last 3 months of pregnancy, there is clear evidence that while the majority of women who are pregnant and get COVID will not be severely unwell, they are much more likely to be severely unwell if they get COVID in the last 3 months of pregnancy than if they were not pregnant. And therefore, the risks of the vaccine were not increased compared to if you are pregnant. The risks of COVID are increased by being pregnant. Therefore, I strongly advise anyone, and I think my rule of thumb is, if it were me, or I'm afraid these days, if it were my daughter, would I be advising her to get the vaccine? And the answer is I'd be marching her down to the pop-in clinic.
Thank you very much, Sarah. That's a very clear answer, and I think that'll be helpful to lots of people. I think we've talked about COVID coming back each winter, so I think we've covered that off. I have a question here about two people, a husband and a wife, who are taking, have two doses of the AstraZeneca vaccine. They're also taking part in the Office for National Statistics COVID infection survey, which you did mention briefly earlier. And they're providing PCR swabs and blood samples on a regular basis. But they've been told that they're still negative for antibodies. So the question is, does this mean that the virus hasn't worked? Sorry, the vaccine hasn't worked? And are they still vulnerable to the virus in theory?
That's interesting. As soon as you said they're part of the ONS study, I thought, oh, they've had their antibodies tested, because of course, if you're part of the study, then this is how they've managed to get such amazing data about the levels of infection across the country. So the answer is, it's complicated. The vast majority of people after two vaccines, the vast majority of people will develop antibodies. And therefore, it's very difficult to know with people who don't have antibodies whether they are in fact protected, just because we don't have enough people to know. However, it is important to remember that it's not just the question of antibodies, that antibodies aren't the whole picture, that your longer lasting immunity tends to come from T cells rather than from antibodies. And therefore it's possible, I don't know how often you were getting tested, but it is possible to, for instance, have no antibodies left, but still have T cell immunity. If you haven't formed antibodies in the first place, I think the likelihood is that your level of protection, I'm afraid, is lower. But for two of you, neither of you to make any antibodies strikes me as very, very odd. And part of me does slightly wonder whether you need your test redoing.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that. And then one last question that I've got here that was previously submitted that says, what do we know about the effectiveness of the vaccines for immunocompromised people?
It's another really good question. And I've had a lot of patients who've come in concerned about that. Because, of course, the whole point about immune compromise or taking medicine to suppress your immune system is that you are given medicine to suppress your immune system if you've got, for instance, rheumatoid arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, lupus, a host of other conditions, in order to stop your body from mounting an immune response, because the body is mounting an immune response and attacking with autoantibodies bits of your body. So what we do know is that the protection offered by one vaccine appears to be very, very low. The latest data we've got is the protection from one vaccine is probably, I fear, only in the region of about 4% protection. However, Public Health England latest data suggests that a second dose boosts protection levels to 74%. So really not very different to that of people who have had the vaccine and who are not immune compromised. The concern is that you may lose that immunity more quickly. And it is for that reason that if you are immune compromised, then I would strongly advise you to check your GP's got that on record to make sure that you are offered a booster in what will be tranche one in the first phase of the booster program, which should be from September, from what I'm hearing, likely to be from the middle of September. And we will be offering flu vaccines wherever possible at the same time, as long as the study, which is currently ongoing, proves that it's safe.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid that we're now towards the end. And so despite the fact that we've got quite a few more questions appearing, we are out of time. But I would like to say thank you very much to Karen and Sarah for the webinar. We've covered a lot of really interesting topics. I think you've done some excellent myth busting and explanations for us, Sarah. So thank you very much. And I do hope that everybody on this webinar found that interesting and important discussion and helped to address issues and questions that we have around the success of COVID as a virus. So if you're interested about other events that we host at the university, then please do visit the webpage. And also, if you'd like to join our mailing list, please email the details will be up shortly. So once again, I'd like to say thank you very much to Sarah and Karen. It's really difficult because under normal circumstances, we'd have a great clap now. So thank you for your contribution. But thank you very much for the webinar and the discussion. And please, everybody, have a good and safe evening. And please wear your masks if you're going out.
Yeah.
Good night.